Thank you, Paul. In January 2004, as Commissioner of the Metropolitan Police Service, I was asked by the Coroner of the Queen's Household and the County of Surrey, Mr. Michael Burgess, to investigate a number of matters surrounding the car crash in Paris on the 31st of August 1997, in which Diana, the Princess of Wales, Mr. Dodi Fayed, and Mr. Henri Paul died, and Mr. Trevor Rees-Jones was seriously injured. The Operation Paget report of that investigation, which has been wide-ranging and thorough, will, I hope, assist the present coroner in charge of the case, Lady Elizabeth Butler-Sloss, to decide the scope of her inquests. This overview that I'm giving you this morning addresses the key issues that have been emerged from what has been a most complex and, I have to say, challenging investigation. The nature of this investigation has been unprecedented, and I decided that only a thorough and detailed investigation would answer these extremely serious allegations. And a dedicated team of New Scotland Yard detectives from the Metropolitan Police Specialist Crime Directorate have worked on the case from the moment I took charge of this investigation. And I want to thank them for their dedication, especially the senior investigating officer and his deputy. Together, we have examined and taken account of the French investigation, but it has not been our role to pass judgment on French procedures and processes. I do, however, recognise that there are differences in the two systems. I must also make it clear that it is not our role to prejudge those matters that will be heard in the coroner's court. It is for Lady Butler-Sloss to decide the questions of who the deceased were and where, when, and how they died. The primary purpose of this investigation has been to assess whether there is credible evidence to support an allegation of conspiracy to murder. And much has been written about the circumstances leading up to the crash, and also the effectiveness of the French investigation that followed. We have been acutely aware of the responsibility that's been placed upon us to approach this investigation with an open mind, to ensure that the outcome was not predetermined. The inquiry has largely concentrated on a number of separate claims made by Mr. Mohammed Al-Fayed and his legal team in documents and public appearances over the 9 years since the crash. At the heart of Mr. Al-Fayed's allegation is his belief that the crash was not an accident, but was murder. Furthermore, that this murder was the result of a conspiracy by the establishment, and in particular by His Royal Highness Prince Philip and the Security and Intelligence Services, because of the relationship between Mr. Dodi Al-Fayed and the Princess of Wales. Mr. Al-Fayed and his legal team have also expressed concern that the investigation by the French authorities was carried out in such a way as to prevent the truth from emerging. Now, I have personally ensured that every reasonable line of inquiry has been undertaken in order to evaluate fully any evidence that might support this extremely serious allegation. We've had excellent cooperation from the French authorities throughout. They've shared the dossier containing the finding of their inquiries to date. They've carried out inquiries on our behalf, given us exhibits, and provided much other practical support to my team. Our understanding of the French inquiry has led us to draw two principal conclusions. First, the differences in procedures between the French and English legal systems in themselves provide answers to some of Mr. Al-Fayed's questions. Second, Mr. Al-Fayed has brought to our attention his concerns about the French investigation, and some of these have received very wide publicity indeed. They do not alter our conclusions in any way. Representatives from government, including the Secret Intelligence Service and the Security Service, have all given me their full cooperation and assistance, whether or not allegations were specifically made against their organizations. Some of these allegations of conspiracy to murder have been made against named individuals in the full glare of publicity. Myself and two members of the team have personally examined MI5 and MI6 records over a long period of time. We've had unprecedented access to everything we have wished to examine. We've contacted the American intelligence services, and they have assured us that they have no relevant information that will in any way affect my conclusions. I am satisfied that no attempt has been made to hold back information, and we are confident that the allegations made are unfounded. The relevant issues are detailed in the report. I would actually say to everybody here, read the 832 pages in that report and digest them. I've been in communication with Prince Philip, Prince Charles, and Prince William. I've spoken with Prince Charles, and I have corresponded with Prince Philip and also Prince William. I've always said that the direction of the investigation would be governed by the evidence, and I've seen nothing that would justify further inquiries with any member of the royal family. I know that this report will be the subject of closer scrutiny than anything I have done before, and people will probably continue to raise issues. It's inevitable. However, this has not stopped the Metropolitan Police from taking the exceptional step of publishing this report. Not only do we believe that it's the right thing to do, but we also believe that the public should have the opportunity to view this investigation in its entirety. And this will allow for properly informed debate about the evidence rather than discussions based on theory and speculation. The team has interviewed 300 witnesses, some for the first time. They've carried out over 500 actions and collected more than 600 exhibits. They've gone wherever necessary in order to pursue their inquiries. More than 20 international letters of request have been submitted to the French authorities, and these inquiries, however, have not been carried out in order to reinvestigate the French inquiry. The team has scrutinized all the statements taken from eyewitnesses at the time in order to assess if there was any possible evidence that might inform the investigation. They have not re-interviewed these witnesses. They did, however, managed to locate and interview two new eyewitnesses, and full accounts have been taken from them. The evidence that they provide has further informed our assessment. Now, eyewitnesses' accounts in France were done in accordance with the French legislation and procedures. The French authorities considered that after this length of time and so much media coverage, the proper place for these accounts to be heard was at the inquests, and many of these witnesses have agreed to attend. Both coroners, Michael Burgess and Lady Elizabeth Butler-Sloss, have agreed that this is the correct and most appropriate course of action, and I agree with them. The recollections of eyewitnesses so many years after such a fleeting and traumatic event have to be dealt with very carefully indeed. We've included in our report extracts from a very informative analysis by a respected psychologist, and he explains these issues in detail. His full report will be made available at the inquests. The team has drawn during the course of the investigation on some of the finest independent experts, and we would like in particular to thank two of them who have been with us throughout the investigation. Professor Robert Forrest is a consultant in clinical chemistry and toxicology. He has provided expert opinion concerning the analysis of Henri Paul's post-mortem samples. Dr. Richard Shepherd is a consultant forensic pathologist and a home office pathologist. And he has given me his expert opinion on the medical condition and the injuries of the Princess of Wales, Dodi Al Fayed, and Henri Paul following the collision. The team has taken advantage of the latest forensic technical developments in the years after the crash. In February 2005, we, together with the French judiciary and police, carried out what I believe is the largest and most comprehensive survey and reconstruction of the scene of an incident ever. We used the specialist skills of surveyors, photographers, computer modelers to collect data from 186 million points and reproduce the scene of the crash and surrounding area within an accuracy of 1 centimeter. This three-dimensional model and validated model of the Mercedes were used by the world-renowned United Kingdom Transport Research Laboratory to simulate and recreate the crash. This groundbreaking work, I believe, as does the team, has been of crucial importance in reaching our conclusions. It will be available to the coroner to consider at the inquest and will be, I hope, of lasting benefit to many other future investigations, whether in this country or abroad. Since 1997, Mr. Mohammed Al Fayed has also employed a number of experts. And they too are eminent in their respective fields. And I am most grateful to him for the many questions he and they have raised and for the information they have provided to the investigation. And Mr. Al Fayed has kindly made many of their reports available to the team. And we've included a great deal of their content in the report. My team, the experts we have employed, have met Mr. Al Fayed's experts, and I have encouraged a constant dialogue between them at all times. Our investigation into the overall allegation of conspiracy to murder has examined the following key areas. The motive for the alleged murder and the opportunity and the capability to carry it out. Our conclusion is that on the evidence available now, there was no conspiracy to murder any occupants of that car. This was a tragic accident. I and the team have spoken to people about sensitive matters, and some of these are of a deeply personal nature. We've spoken to close relatives, friends, and the doctor of the Princess of Wales, and all were very willing to help me in any way they could. And I am most grateful for their cooperation and assistance. We're not prepared to go into detail as much of what we have been told was on the understanding that it would be accorded proper sensitivity. And I'm sure all of you in this room will understand that. However, we are certain that the Princess of Wales was not pregnant at the time of her death. Our conclusions were strengthened by forensic tests carried out on blood recovered from the Mercedes car when we brought it back to this country. From the evidence of her close friends and associates, she was not engaged, and she was not about to get engaged. To stage an accident in order to murder the occupants of the car would, in my opinion, require careful, meticulous, and coordinated planning. The team carried out a detailed and thorough investigation of the events leading up to the collusion. From the very first beginnings of the relationship between the Princess of Wales and Mr. Dodi Al Fayed in St. Tropez in July of 1997. To the particular sequence of events which took place a few weeks later in Paris on the evening of the 30th of August 1997. The paparazzi were intent on following their every move from the moment they knew of the relationship and were aware of their plans to travel to Paris on Saturday, the 30th of August. Having been informed by contacts, they were waiting for them at the airport and they followed them to the Ritz Hotel. At 7 p.m. that evening, Dodi Al Fayed and the Princess of Wales left the Ritz Hotel to go to Dodi Al Fayed's apartment in the Rue Hossein Houssay. They had no intention of returning to the Ritz Hotel that night. We're also certain that Henri Paul had no intention of returning to the Ritz Hotel after he went off duty shortly after they departed. For a number of reasons, the plans of all three individuals changed. The Princess of Wales and Dodi Al Fayed had planned to dine at a well-known Paris restaurant at about 9:40 p.m., and they were on the way being driven there. It was because of the attention of the paparazzi during this journey that Dodi Al Fayed instructed his chauffeur to drive instead to the Ritz Hotel. They arrived there at 9:50 that evening. This was unexpected, and consequently the night duty security officer called Henri Paul on his mobile phone and told him of their arrival. Henri Paul apparently expressed surprise but immediately returned to the hotel. And all of the evidence we have examined indicates that that was entirely in keeping with Henri Paul's conscientious approach to his work. And much has been made of the missing 3 hours between him leaving the Ritz Hotel and returning on that Saturday evening. Nobody can be exactly sure where he was and what he was doing during those 3 hours. But it is clear that until he was telephoned at about 10 p.m., by the Ritz Hotel night duty security officer, he cannot have known that he would be returning to the Ritz Hotel, and neither did anybody else. Once back at the Ritz Hotel, Dodi Al Fayed had a conversation with his father. Mohammed Al Fayed recalls that Dodi informed him of his wish to return to the apartment in the Rue Hossein Houssay in order to present the Princess of Wales with an engagement ring. Dodi Al Fayed had purchased a ring for her that afternoon from Rapotti Jewellers. The Princess of Wales was not with him at the time, and we believe that she never saw that ring. Now, I don't know whether Dodi was going to ask her to marry him that night, and I cannot say what the Princess of Wales' response would have been. However, we have spoken to many of her family and closest friends, and none of them has indicated to us that she was either about to or wished to get engaged. Her last conversations with friends and confidants were to the contrary. Prince William has confirmed to me that his mother had not given him the slightest indication about such plans for the future. At around 10:20 p.m., Dodi Al Fayed passed a message to Henri Paul through the night duty manager. Another car would now be required to take the couple back to his apartment in the Rue Hossein Houssay. This car was to depart from the rear of the Ritz Hotel. The driver, the car, and the point of departure all therefore changed within a very short space of time. This left no opportunity, in my opinion, for anyone to put any action into plan. particularly one that will require so much preparation and so many people to effect it. At around 12:20 a.m. on Sunday the 31st of August 1997, the Princess of Wales, Dodi Al Fayed, and Trevor Rees-Jones left the Ritz Hotel in a Mercedes driven by Henri Paul. As we know, Dodi's chauffeur-driven car and backup vehicle were to depart from the front of the hotel shortly afterwards. The French investigation traced and identified many eyewitnesses, including drivers and their vehicles. There may be other eyewitnesses who have not come forward, but I'm confident on the evidence that we have now that a full and comprehensive picture of the events is there. We know the car travelled at excessive speed during the final part of the journey, while again being followed by the paparazzi. We know the route it took. We can say with certainty that the car hit the curb just before the 13th pillar of the central reservation in the Alma underpass at a speed of around 61 to 63 miles per hour. And this is about twice the speed limit of that section of the road. Now, what exactly happened at the end of that journey is a matter for the inquest to decide. However, we conclude that nothing in the very rapid sequence of events we have reconstructed supports the allegation of conspiracy to murder. In particular, following the work done by police collision investigators and other experts, we are confident that any theories concerning flashing lights inside the Alma underpass can be discounted as a cause for that crash. We do believe that there was a glancing contact between the Mercedes driven by Henri Paul and a white Fiat Uno just before the Alma underpass. And much has been made of the French photojournalist, Mr. James Andanson. It's been alleged that he was the driver of the Fiat Uno, and also that he was an agent of the security services. Well, we're completely satisfied that this Fiat Uno did not belong to James Andanson, and nor was it driven by him that night. James Andanson committed suicide in May of the year 2000, and shortly afterwards, the offices he shared in Paris were burgled. The French conducted a full investigation into his death, and we agree with their conclusions that James Andanson took his own life. Despite claims to the contrary, the burglary was fully investigated, and known professional criminals were arrested and convicted. There is no evidence that James Andanson was an agent for any security service. In August 1997, James Andanson did own a white Fiat Uno, a popular make and model of car at that time. However, it was 9 years old. It was in a state of disrepair, had been driven over 360,000 kilometers, and was registered in his own name. He openly part-exchanged the car for a Fiat Puno at a local garage later that year. James Andanson's widow has given the team her full cooperation and her assistance. It must have been difficult for her, and I'm grateful for her assistance. We are satisfied that James Andanson was at home with his wife on the night of Saturday the 30th of August, before flying to Corsica on a photographic assignment the following morning. Who was driving the white Fiat Uno, and why they did not come forward, are questions we have considered. The French investigation carried out a major search for the Fiat Uno, but they couldn't locate the car. And after this length of time, it's very unlikely that we shall do so. Failing to render assistance to a person in danger is an imprisonable offence in French law. And this may have deterred witnesses from coming forward and giving their account. We're also convinced that the French authorities took all reasonable steps to save the lives of those involved in the accident. We have seen the surgeons and medical staff who worked so hard that night to try and save the lives of those involved in the crash. I believe they did everything humanly possible to do that. Much has been said about the embalming of the body of the Princess of Wales, and that this formed some part of the conspiracy. We have found the explanation for this, and we understand why it was done. Again, the details are in the report. It's clear that the Mercedes was travelling at excessive speeds as it approached the Alma underpass. Henri Paul had consumed alcohol that evening. After returning to the Ritz Hotel, he drank two Ricards in the bar Vendôme. And this alone would have given him an alcohol level near the French drug driving limit, which is lower than the limit in this country. When Henri Paul returned, he could not have known he was going to be driving the Princess of Wales and Dodi Fayed that night. On the CCTV, he does appear to be walking round the hotel normally, but the tests on the forensic samples taken at both of his postmortems show him to have an alcohol level of around 1.74 grams per litre at the time of the crash. This is around twice the British drink drive limit. We are satisfied from DNA testing carried out on samples in France and brought over to this country and examined by experts in the United Kingdom that those blood samples tested belonged to Henri Paul. Henri Paul had been drinking, but how much he had consumed is questionable. There has also been speculation surrounding the abnormal levels of carboxyhemoglobin in Henri Paul's blood. The team, after a meticulous search, has identified an explanation for this high reading. The information was shared with Mohammed Al-Fayed's team. It concerns how and from where the sample was taken, and we've worked together to find an answer to this. In conclusion, I have no doubt that speculation as to what happened that night will continue. And there are some matters, as in many other investigations, about which we will never find a definitive answer. However, I do not believe that any evidence currently exists that can substantiate the allegation of conspiracy to murder. Various legal cases are being pursued by Mr. Al-Fayed through the French courts. They are unlikely, in my opinion, to have any bearing on my conclusion that there was no conspiracy and that there was no cover-up. Three people tragically lost their lives in the accident, and one was seriously injured. Many more have suffered from the intense scrutiny, speculation, misinformed judgments in the years that have followed. I hope that all the work that we have done over the last 3 years and the publication of this report will help to bring some closure to all those who continue to mourn the death of Diana, Princess of Wales, Dodi Al-Fayed, and Henri Paul.
Thank you, Lord Stevens. Just before we take questions, I'd just like to give some details about how to obtain copies of the reports. Those of you here, at the end of the press conference, there'll be a copy of Lord Stevens' overview report for you to take away. We also have the full report and the overview report on a CD-ROM. So we've got copies of that as well for you. We have made arrangements for these also to be available by the Press Association and by the Foreign Press Association. And during this press conference, copies of the reports have been emailed to news desks and also to those of you who pre-registered with us. We've made arrangements with a number of media outlets to make the reports available to the wider public via their websites, and these will be signposted through the Metropolitan Police website. Obviously, if there is a large volume of downloads of the files, it could take time to download them. And if there are any other media who wish to publish the report on their website, could I please ask you to speak to the Scotland Yard Press Bureau to make the necessary arrangements. And now there's an opportunity to take some questions. I'd be grateful if you could wait for a microphone to get to you, and if you would give your name and the media you represent before you ask the question. So, can you come across the front?
Thank you. Nicholas Witchell, BBC. Lord Stevens, Mr. Al-Fayed is suggesting that you have not spoken to a number of critical witnesses. He is suggesting that you've been forced, indeed blackmailed, into your conclusion by British intelligence. He's saying, in effect, that this is a whitewash and a cover-up. Can I ask both you and, indeed, Chief Superintendent Douglas, what your response to those suggestions is?
If I may, I'll speak on behalf of Chief Superintendent Douglas on this issue. Obviously, we've discussed it. We've done a lot of hard work in relation to this matter, and I've obviously seen Mohammed Al-Fayed on a number of occasions. And I, for one, know that he is a genuinely grieving parent. I have no more to say about it than that, and I don't want to take it any further than that. He's a grieving parent. He is entitled to say what he has, and I make no comment on it whatsoever.
John
Toomey. Sir, John Toomey from the Daily Express. You touched on this in your opening remarks, but could you expand a little more on the reasons behind publication of this report and the balance between the possible prejudice of legal proceedings and the information you've given to the public today?
I think this is a very difficult balance to strike, John. There is obviously a massive, as you've heard from the Deputy Commissioner, a massive public interest in relation to what we have discovered. I've stressed this morning that we do not want to get in the way or prejudge what takes place at the coroner's inquests in due course. But I do believe the allegations that have been made are so serious in relation to Prince Philip, security services, in relation to what they've been accused of doing, that they are entitled, as are others who have been accused of other acts within the security services, of having an answer to what has been very serious allegations indeed. And that's why we've published it. And it's for others to read this in detail. There are 832 pages here. Please, please read the totality of this report. Don't just hone in on certain parts of it. It needs to be read together and in whole.
Another one just here.
Yes, Marc Roche of Le Monde for Lord Stevens. The main difference with the French inquiry is that you seem to put more guilt on the paparazzi than the French because they got away in France. Can you go into explaining why this rather emphasis on the paparazzi?
Well, in relation to the paparazzi, we're not putting guilt in any particular area. Let me explain. A crash of this nature is similar to a major crash of an airline, for instance. There's a long chain of events. Take any link out of that chain, and this wouldn't have happened. The French have investigated the paparazzi. I believe six or eight of those members were arrested, and we have no more to say about that at the present time. Again, I'd encourage you to read the report.
James Mates from ITV News. You say this was a tragic accident. Was anyone to blame for this accident? Was it Mohammed Al-Fayed or members of his staff or the paparazzi or Henri Paul?
At the end of the day, as I said, you know, this is a long chain of events that led to this accident. I make no assumptions of who is to blame. I think there is a lot of evidence that presumably will be given at the inquest when that is and how that's decided, and the format of that is a matter for the coroner. I lay no blame at anyone's door.
Nicholas Davies, I'm an author. It's probably included in your report, which of course we have not yet read, but can you tell us now what the situation is with reference to the seat belts in the Mercedes and why it appears that Princess Diana was not belted up, despite the fact that we know from the bodyguard, Rhys Jones, that he did belt up before the car, the Mercedes, entered the underpass? Thank you.
I think that's one of the areas we don't know a specific answer to. What went on in the car between Dodi, the Princess, and Trevor, we don't know, let alone Henri Paul. What I can say is this, that had they been wearing the seat belts, it may well be that they might not have died.
Sir, can I?
Yes.
May I just say there, just for clarity, that the tests that have been carried out by the Transport Research Laboratory will show that Trevor Rhys-Jones was not wearing a seatbelt at the time of the crash. None of the occupants of the vehicle had their seatbelt strapped when the crash occurred.
No, sorry, we've got plenty of people on questions, so I'll move on. Thank you.
Thank you. Maria Almendra McBride from USA Hispanic and Mexico Radio. Lord Stevens, if what is very important is the life more than the death of the Princess of Wales, and if for the sake of the Royal Highnesses, Prince William, Prince Harry, and Prince Charles, and the rest of the royal family, is a theme of reconciliation in 2007. I'm interested to know, for you particular, and of course, Detective Douglas and Detective Stevenson, what does the life of the Princess of Wales and her then partner Dodi Fayed and their chauffeur Henri Paul as human beings mean to you? What would you say they are telling you as human beings with all these that you've had to carry with your shoulders over the months?
Well, I mean, we've dealt with on a regular basis different families and different relatives of those who died. That's why I make no comment in relation to Mohammed in terms of what he said today and yesterday about me. He's a genuinely grieving parent. Make no mistake about that. However, there are other people who are grieving also. 3 weeks ago, I saw Henri Paul's parents. They are grieving. Make no mistake, this has been a traumatic event. And that's why at some stage of the process, people have to draw a line under it and move on. So I hope, you know, this is part of the process, as I said earlier, at my end of my overview. I just hope this adds and helps to that process.
Lord Stevens, Jimmy Burns, Financial Times. I too, obviously, together with everybody else here, haven't had a chance to read the full 800. But just for the benefit, for the record, I wonder if you could just comment on two aspects of the intelligence and security agency conspiracies. One, that Henri Paul had some involvement with the secret intelligence agencies, either the French or the British. And two, the fact that a lot of the conspiracy theory was fueled by a sworn affidavit by a former member of MI6, Mr. Tomlinson, who claimed that there was a clear similarity between the alleged conspiracy to murder the Princess of Wales and a plot to assassinate President Milosevic in Serbia.
If I can deal with Henri Paul to start off with, it is a matter of practice in France at well-known locations to ensure that they have an informative source at those particular locations. And Henri Paul was a low-level informative source, not just, I think, to the French Secret Service, but to the police generally. It's also of interest that these sources are not paid by the French government. They do it for whatever reason. Dealing with MI5 and MI6 in particular, we spent 3 weeks, mainly in MI6, looking at the records, being allowed to go where we wanted to go, and examining all of their records in a way that's never been allowed before in this country. And we found no trace of information coming from Henri Paul. We also found no trace in terms of anything that would add and give evidence which would aid the theory of conspiracy to murder and those organisations being involved in that. If we deal with the conspiracy in relation to Tomlinson and his evidence, which we have in the report in detail, you will see that further statement was taken from him, and that's detailed in the report, and I'd ask you to look at it in detail before you come to any conclusions. Thank you.
June Kelly, BBC. There have been suggestions that Diana was being bugged by American intelligence.
That's an area where we have gone as far as we can in terms of the American side of what has taken place. We've been in touch with the CIA and the CSA over there. They inform us that there is nothing in their records, either in relation to telephone conversations, that actually would assist or otherwise this investigation. Further, what we've done is that we have looked at the records of MI5 and MI6, and in my view, if there was any information that would have been of assistance or involved in a conspiracy, those records would have shown some traces. They did not. David, do you want to take that any further?
Yes, possibly the only other thing to say there is that one of the reasons, I think, why the Deputy Commissioner has decided to publish this report is so that those sort of facts can be put into context. For example, I know there have been some claims this week that the Princess of Wales was having her telephone conversations listened into by the American services. Now, that's a very difficult thing to prove or disprove. I hope what the report will show that when you put that into context, even if that had been happening, what would that have told them? And you have to look at what the Princess of Wales was saying to her close friends and to her confidants on Saturday the 30th of August and to her very close family in that week and what those conversations were about. So that even if you take the premise that she was being listened to, you have to look at what those people listening would have heard. And they'd have heard the Princess of Wales talking about coming home to see her sons, and not talking about engagement or pregnancy or any of the other supporting theories around the conspiracy to murder.
Tony Al-Khoury from Al Arabiya News Channel in Dubai. Just a question to Lord Stevens. How important is the Fiat Uno link in your investigation, and why did it prove to be problematic to find it for the French and for yourselves? Thanks.
I mean, this is an area of difficulty because we don't want to get in the way of the evidence given to the coroner's court. But when I talked about the reconstruction of what took place in that crash, the Fiat Uno was involved on a glancing blow. And all I can say, without prejudging or prejudicing what the evidence would be at the inquest, is that the reconstruction showed that perhaps there was a loss of control of that vehicle before it may well have had a glancing blow on the Uno. Now, in relation to tracing the driver, as I said, that's quite a difficult issue. I mean, the French, without any doubt, and you remember it was the Brigade Criminale who was involved in this investigation, the creme de la creme of the French investigative system. They're used to dealing with terrorist offences and the like. They had no successful conclusion to this. There was James Andanson, and there was another person that was interviewed, as you probably remember, whose car had actually changed, the individual had changed the colour of the car a day or two later from white to red. But I have to say, from our own conclusions, I think it's going to be very difficult to trace who that driver was with any certainty. And remember, we're talking about certainty here, not speculation.
Stuart Tandler from The Times. I wonder, Lord Stevens, if you could enlarge on your comments about two new witnesses who have come forward and what significance they've had in your conclusions.
David, do you want to take that through?
We've taken full statements from two new eyewitnesses. And it's interesting talking about eyewitnesses in France earlier and why we haven't re-interviewed them, because they made their accounts at the time. I think what has to be remembered about these eyewitnesses that Paget hasn't seen is that they made their statements to the French police within hours of the crash, and some within days of the crash, and some were seen once, twice, three times by the examining magistrate and others. The two witnesses that we have now found who are eyewitnesses were not interviewed by the French. They are English-speaking witnesses, and we have taken full statements from them, because this is the first record that they have made about what they saw. As Lord Stevens said in his introduction, that is factored into his conclusions. They will be very useful to the inquest process in terms of explaining exactly what happened, but we have assessed their evidence against the conspiracy theory, and we are satisfied that what they tell us adds nothing to the conspiracy allegation.
Emma Birchley, Sky News. What further evidence with regards to the engagement conspiracy, what evidence do you have of a ring having been bought or any further plans that Dodi had for that evening?
Well, certainly a ring was bought, but as I said earlier, we don't know exactly when Dodi was intending, if that was the case, of actually giving Princess Diana that ring and the circumstances surrounding giving that ring. All I can tell you is this, with absolute certainty, is that those who spoke to the princess within 2 to 3 hours prior to her death and over that period of time have categorically said she had no intention whatsoever of getting engaged or getting married.
Amir Nabil from the Egyptian TV. My question is for Lord Stevens. How do you comment about what was said that Prince Philip does not want or did not want the mother of the future king to be engaged to a Muslim?
Well, I mean, that's speculation. There is no evidence, in fact, in relation to the letters that were sent, that that's there. That's, again, part of the speculation.
Yes, I'll take that one next time.
Channel 5 News. Lord Stevens, you've said you've been in correspondence with Prince William. Can you tell us, if you will, how the princes reacted to your findings, in particular with regards to what you told them about the foreign paparazzi?
I saw both princes personally last night for a reasonably long period of time. I have no intention at all of disclosing what those conversations were. They are personal, they are private, and they will remain so.
Paul Callum, Daily Express. It was fairly widely reported that Princess Diana had said that, predicted rather pessimistically, that she may well have an accident. Do you put this down to a bit of her own moody pessimism, or just a flip remark, or do you think she really expected something horrendous to happen to her?
Do you know, I don't think we can answer that with any certainty. I mean, there is no doubt at all from some of the interviews that were made specifically to interviewers, it seems to be some premonition, but at the end of the day, it's what kind of cognizance you give to those premonitions. All we can say is that, you know, that's actually been part and parcel of what we've considered.
Mike Sullivan at The Sun. You mentioned briefly that you found an explanation for why Princess of Wales was embalmed. Could you just shortly outline the explanation?
This is one of the sensitive areas that it's quite difficult to go into for certain reasons. You will find in the report we go as far as I think we can. But the reasons she was embalmed were for presentation reasons. And the decision in relation to the embalming was made by the embalmer at the time, also by the head of the Brigade Criminale, in terms of she was acting on behalf of the Prefect of Paris, and also an individual who was a police bodyguard came over there, and he was involved in that decision. And I think we don't really want to go any further in relation to that.
We've heard that...
Lord Stevens, John Steele from the Daily Telegraph. Do you anticipate that the inquest now can be narrowed down to the few simple questions about who she was, where she died, etc., or is it just going to become a battleground in which lawyers for Mr. Fayed will challenge your report? And secondly, do you accept that there is a section of the community, particularly in this internet era, who are never ever going to believe your conclusions?
In relation to the inquest, of course, that's totally a matter for the coroner, and I've no doubt that there will be a large amount of discussion over the scope of the inquest, the scale of it, and indeed who gives evidence. And that's not an issue we intend to get involved in at all. Section of the community, I think there will be a number of people who find it very hard to accept what the conclusions are that we've come up with. It's extraordinary, even some friends of mine have actually questioned that whether if I came across something I would disclose it. They know me better than they know that I would. But there will be certain small sections, I think, or certain sections of the community will not accept what we're saying. All I'm saying is this. What we're saying and the reason that the Deputy Commissioner has taken this unusual step of publishing this report, read that in total. Get the whole picture rather than certain aspects that sometimes people have concentrated on.
We've heard that the death of James Anderson was a suicide in his car. It's always been said that the door was locked and there were no keys found. Is that true? In which case, how does that can be explained?
Well, I mean, the French police conducted a very, very intensive investigation in relation to his death. The circumstances of his death are actually similar to one death that I went to myself personally in Cambridgeshire. And it was quite interesting to see the similarities of that death and how that person committed suicide. I think I'd invite you to look at the report in detail, especially the evidence of his wife, and more particularly in respect of the suicide, the evidence of what his friend said, where he actually predicted what he might do if he had certain problems.
Adrian Arsenault, Canadian Broadcasting. I'm just curious about the non-functioning of the CCTV cameras. There's lots of talk about that and of this man who may have had a speeding ticket just 15 minutes before they suddenly weren't working. Many people seem to cling to that as evidence of some sort of conspiracy. What can you say to that?
I think that's right. If I just in general, then I'm going to come to Dave, who actually dealt with that part of the inquiry. I think people need to understand that the French have a different approach to CCTV and cameras than we do in this country. And that approach actually was about turning those cameras off and the actual control room not working after a certain period of time. In this country that doesn't happen, but in France it does, David.
Mm. I'm interested in the way the question was phrased, actually, the way you said the evidence of the speeding ticket. It's one of these things why I think, again, coming back to the Deputy Commissioner publishing this full report, in terms of looking at the evidence, I would suggest to you that there's actually some speculation around a speeding ticket rather than evidence of it. It links into something else, which is a photograph which has been used quite a lot, where you see Henri Paul, Trevor Rhys-Jones, the Princess and Dodi in the back of the car, which again was meant to have been taken as they entered the Alma underpass. Now, the evidence around that photograph is that it was taken at the rear of the Ritz Hotel in Rue Cambon as they were leaving. And we've identified the photographer who took that, and it fits into the whole sequence of events. So yes, it perhaps comes back to some of the earlier questions around speculation will always be around this. And I think it's one of the reasons why the Deputy Commissioner has published this, so that if you look at the evidence and put it into context. In terms of the CCTV cameras, Judge Hervé Stéphane, who took over this case on the 2nd of September, he ordered the Brigade Criminel to track the route of the Mercedes and to see what CCTV was there, what photographic opportunities were there. There is a full report in the French dossier, and we have reproduced it in our report, that explains the inquiries that they took. And they have found no CCTV that could have been any use in terms of tracking the Mercedes. And it just links into what Lord Stevens said, which is in 1997 in Paris, you have to put it in a context of the CCTV situation then, as opposed to London in 2006.
I just wonder if I could add one quick thing. Mm. Just in support of what David has said and also Lord Stevens, of course, I do think it is now time for this public debate to be informed by the most thorough inquiry that it's been possible to undertake. And I would endorse Lord Stevens' comments. It is now time to read the detail of that report, because many of these questions are either answered in that report or would not be asked if you get the chance to read it.
Agreed.
I'm going to take two more questions. One at the back.
Sarah Hughes, Sky News. Lord Stevens, when you started this inquiry almost 3 years ago, you said you'd leave no stone unturned. Are you confident that that is what you've done, despite the outstanding questions, for example, about the Fiat Uno?
Absolutely. The team, there's been 12 of us working on this and led very ably by David on a day-to-day basis, with me having an overall direction and control of it, we have left no stone unturned. We have been determined, absolutely determined, to ensure that we get to the truth of some of these allegations in relation to the allegation of conspiracy to murder that had been made. Let me stress this now. These are incredibly serious allegations to make against people. And those people are entitled to a very thorough investigation indeed. And we've done that.
There's been various estimates as to how much the inquiries cost. Do you have a definitive version?
Perhaps I can deal with that. To be as precise as possible, Duncan, £3.69 million is the total global cost, and that includes everything, wages, logistics. The total cost is £3.69 million.
Including the cost of the offices and the furniture in the offices, every single thing.
Thank you very much.